This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Friends, welcome to this worship service with the congregation of First Presbyterian Church of Mesa. I am delighted that God is continuing to gather us together and that you have tuned in for this time of worship on this Pentecost Sunday. And what a glorious and joyful day it will be. We will celebrate Pentecost, and we also will be celebrating confirmation and welcoming four confirmands into the life of our congregation. So it is going to be a wonderful and joyful time of worship this morning. I have just a couple of announcements. We will receive the Pentecost offering, so if you care to contribute to this offering, please feel free to do so online or send a check to the church or drop one off at the office. Next week is our Youth Sunday, so we will look forward to the youth leading us in worship next Sunday. The La Palabra, our newsletter, was sent out on Thursday of last week, and if you haven't had a chance to look at it yet, please do so. There is an update in the newsletter on our reopening task force. So it goes through some of the details of the guidelines that we are following in order to safely and prudently look towards coming together again in person for worship. And now I invite you to watch a video produced by Shelley Cronenberg, our elder for mission, on the Pentecost offering. And she will tell you where our portion of that offering will be allocated towards this year.
Hi, everyone. I wanted to take a moment for mission to talk to you about Pentecost. Pentecost is one of our four special offerings that we do each year. And what's exciting about Pentecost is that it has a major focus on young adult and youth and building a life of faith. One of the cool things that our funds go to, our offering donations go to, is a program called Educate a Child, Transform the World. And there are different communities all over that do something special for this. But the First Presbyterian Church of Oak Ridge, Tennessee, they are organized tutors for the local elementary school, and nearly half of those tutors come from the church. And what makes this even more special is that Willow Brook Elementary School sits in one of the lowest income neighborhoods of Oak Ridge, and many parents have to work multiple jobs. Some are incarcerated and some are absent. This program has helped build relationships between the tutor and the student, where the child can have another adult to count on, and it makes the children more excited about learning. And this is just one of the many different things that your Pentecost offering money goes to. This Pentecost offering allows the church to decide where 40% goes to help a local organization. And our church has decided to take the 40% and use it for our very own First Presbyterian preschool. And some of you remember that there was an Easter breakfast planned, and money was going to be raised to help fix the slide that's broken in our playground. And obviously this got canceled. And so we thought we could take this 40% and fix up the slides and really help out the First Presbyterian preschool. So I know everybody's financial situation is different right now, but if you are able to, I would like to invite you to graciously give to this offering. And I just wanted to end us in a little prayer. So thank you so much. Jesus, you called all children to you and did not turn them away. Let this church support all children to develop in mind, body, and spirit, so that the potential you gave each of them might be known and shared to your glory. Amen. Thank you so much, and I hope you all are doing well.
Will you join me in prayer? God in heaven, you surprised and amazed your disciples at Pentecost. We praise you for the Spirit who still fills our lives and hearts. Send your mighty spirits upon us as we worship, Fill us with joy and wonder. Come wind, come fire, come truth, come love. Let us worship God.
Come, Holy Spirit, rain upon our dry and dusty lives. Wash away our sin and heal our wounded spirits. Kindle within us the fire of your love and burn away our apathy. With your warmth, bend our wills and guide our wandering feet. Hear us now as we confess our sin together. Let us pray. Generous God, you send us the spirit of courage, and yet we have been afraid. You send us the spirit of truth, but we cling to our illusions. You send us the spirit of healing, but we have difficulty letting go of our hurts. Holy Spirit of forgiveness, come to us again. Shake loose our hearts. Set our souls on fire with your love. Send us out into the world rejoicing in your power. Let us be lampposts of your love and beacons of your light. We pray this in the power and presence of your most Holy Spirit. Amen. Hear now these words of assurance. Through the prophet Ezekiel, God spoke, "I will take you out of the nations. I will gather you from all the countries. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. You will be my people, and I will be your God." Friends in Christ, by the power of the Spirit, we are united with Christ and given a new spirit. Live in the joy and peace of that assurance. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen.
Good morning. Good to see you today. I have the story of the first Pentecost. What do you feel like when someone you love goes away? Maybe the disciples felt that way after Jesus went to be with God. After Easter, when Jesus came back, he told the disciples to wait in Jerusalem for the gift of the Holy Spirit. So the story begins in Jerusalem. The disciples waited together 50 days, and they were still waiting in Jerusalem. This day was Pentecost, which was a Jewish festival. On this day, Jews remember how God gave the Ten Commandments to Moses on Mount Sinai. The city was filled with visitors from many lands. The disciples were waiting together in a house. Suddenly, the wind whooshed around them. It howled into every corner of the room. With a great flash, little flames of fire danced over each person's head, but no one was burned. The Holy Spirit was in the house. The Holy Spirit helped them speak languages they didn't know before. The noise of everyone speaking carried beyond the walls. People on the street heard the disciples speaking in their languages. "How is this happening?" they asked each other. "Those people are from Galilee. How do they learn my language?" It was such a strange thing that some people said, "They must be drunk." Peter said, "We're not drunk. We're full of the Holy Spirit." Then the Holy Spirit, Peter told them all about Jesus, about the Holy Spirit included. He told them how the prophets prepared everyone for the coming of Jesus. He told the people about God's love for them. He told them that Jesus was killed. He also told them that Jesus came back from the dead. Peter said, "God sent Jesus for all of us to save us." Many people in the crowd wanted to know what they were supposed to do. Peter said, "Change your ways and follow God. Be baptized. Ask God for forgiveness. Then you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit too." 3,000 people were baptized that day, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. So Pentecost happened about 50 days after Jesus was resurrected on Easter. And it's such a wonderful time that what happened here was Jesus sent everyone a helper. That helper was the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is with us today, and we celebrate that. A lot of people were saved that day and learned about Jesus and were baptized. So to this day, we still not only baptize people on Pentecost, but we bring new members into the church. And we're doing such that this morning as far as bringing in our confirmands who've been through our confirmation program. Would you pray with me? Loving God, we are so thankful for the Holy Spirit that still enlightens us every day. May that just reign over us. Be with our confirmands and our members of our church, that we may show your love to others. And that we pray. Amen.
Jesus loves me, this I know. Jesus loves me.
Now would you please join me in prayer for illumination? Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Now would you please join me to hear these words from the prophet Joel, Joel 2, verses 26 to 29. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, who has dealt wondrous with you, and my people shall never again be put to shame. You shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I, the Lord, am your God, and there is no other one. And my people shall never again be put to shame. Then afterward, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your younger men shall see visions. Even on the male and female slaves, in those days, I'll pour out my spirit. Thank you.
Our New Testament reading comes from the book of Acts, the story of the first Pentecost and the promise of the Holy Spirit. Luke has written his gospel, and now he's going on to write the story of the early church. Hear these words of Holy Scripture. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during the 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or the periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth.
When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability.
But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonder, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know, this man handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power.
This Jesus God raised up, and all that were of us are witnesses. And being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this that you both see and hear. Therefore, let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you crucified.
Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord God calls to him." Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This is the day of Pentecost, the day of rushing winds and tongues of fire, a day of joy and wonder, as we will sing together to close our time of worship this morning. It is a day of celebrating the promises of baptism, the faithfulness of God, and the ongoing presence of Christ through the gift of the Holy Spirit. On this first Pentecost that we just read about in Acts, very shortly after Jesus died and rose again, many people from all over the Middle East were gathered together in Jerusalem. You see, Pentecost, like Passover, was one of the three pilgrimage festivals for the Jews. So they were required to travel to Jerusalem to celebrate the feast. The feast was also known as Shavuot, or the Festival of Weeks, and it was celebrated 7 weeks after the beginning of the barley harvest. Pentecost means the 50th day. And according to both tradition and Jewish law, the feast began 7 full weeks when you first put the sickle to the standing grain. And today, as Chris indicated, we celebrate Pentecost 50 days after Easter, after the resurrection of Jesus Christ our Lord. It was a feast of first fruits, reminding us that we are to give our best to God. Pentecost was a joyous celebration with grain offerings and drink offerings, a time to remember and give thanks for God's many, many blessings and God's provision. It was a time to rejoice in the goodness of God. Today, too, is a time of great celebration, a time to rejoice in God's many blessings. The blessing of faith being one of the greatest of these gifts. Now, on this particular Pentecost celebration, the one just following Jesus' death and resurrection, something very strange happened. Indeed, everyone who was gathered there, praying and waiting and praying, they all had the same sense that this event marked a significant transition in time. It was a big deal. The sound of a mighty wind came rushing in as the Spirit blew her powerful energy, filling everyone in the room and gifting them with newfound abilities and aptitudes. They began to speak in different languages, though each one heard in their native tongue. Gathered together under the power of God's Holy Spirit were people, devout Jews from every nation, from east and west and north and south. All were amazed and astonished. Peter took the lead, recalling the prophecy of Joel and calling all to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Peter reminded them of the prophecy that the Spirit would one day be poured out upon all flesh, And by the power of the Spirit, young and old alike would see visions and dream dreams. Both sons and daughters would prophesy, and everyone who called on the name of the Lord would be saved, healed, restored, and made new. By the Spirit's work within and among us, we too can see visions and dream dreams. And we might even be led in this, I think, by our young people, our confirmands. Visions of the world that God intends for it to be, a place of peace and shalom for all people, a place of healing and wholeness for all of creation. We can dream dreams of no more violence or war, no abuse of power or corruption, no disease or pandemics. We can imagine physical and other deep hungers being satisfied, people of all nations and cultures and languages living and working together for the healing of the earth and of humanity. This sort of envisioning, imagining, and dreaming encapsulates the Jewish priority known as Tikkun Olam, the repair of the world. Pentecost was truly a day of great cosmic significance, a festive day in our salvation history, a day that calls forth deep faith. And today is also one of great significance. Not only do we celebrate Pentecost, the pouring out of the Spirit upon all flesh, God giving to us God's own Spirit to dwell within us, and also giving us spiritual gifts to develop and use for God's glory and for the coming of God's reign on earth, but we also today get to celebrate the confirmation of baptismal vows and the profession of faith by four confirmands. It is a significant day in their lives, certainly, and also a significant and celebratory day in the life of our congregation. Now, in our Reformed tradition, in the Presbyterian stream of the Christian faith, we baptize folks at any point along life's spectrum. I have baptized infants, toddlers, teenagers, and adults. And there are promises involved in this sacrament of baptism. As Peter exclaimed on Pentecost, "Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus, so that your sins may be forgiven and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." And then Peter talks about the promise of baptism. He says, "This promise is for you, for your children, for all who are far away, yes, everyone whom the Lord calls to him." Rebecca, Flora, Ben, and Marette, when you were baptized, the congregation in which you were baptized made promises on your behalf. They promised to help you learn about Jesus, to teach you about God's love for you, to show you how to show forth God's love by serving others. They promised to stand by your side in worship so that you would grow in your love and knowledge of God. Your parents also made promises on your behalf. They promised to help you know and love and follow Jesus Christ, to show you God's love and to help you center your life on Christ. And today, on this Confirmation Sunday, as you claim your faith for yourself, you will confirm those baptismal vows and profess your own faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior. And so this morning, with great joy, we affirm God's ongoing action in your life from birth. We know, we have seen, we have been witnesses of how the Spirit has been active in your lives, guiding you, gifting you, leading you to this time and to this place in your faith journey. As Presbyterians, we acknowledge our humility and we confess the mystery of the sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper, confident that the Holy Spirit is indeed active and mighty in both. But we do not know the exact moment when God pours out God's Spirit. And so we simply and humbly acknowledge God's gracious gift of the Spirit and connect it to baptism as a visible sign and a seal of this wondrous gift. You all are amazing. You rose to the challenge of a confirmation class during a global pandemic. Not many confirmands can say that. God is surely at work within each of you, forming you and shaping you into the people that God has created you to become. God has great plans for you. I'm sure of it. And so on this important day, you will profess your faith in Jesus Christ. You will commit your life to God, even as God has already been committed to your full flourishing and abundant life. This is a lifelong journey, this growing in Christ, growing in faith, growing in understanding of what it means to follow Jesus and to love God with your whole being, heart, mind, and soul. It's also something that we covenant, that we promise to do together as a family of faith, as a community united in the bonds of this Holy Spirit. You are not alone. We and God are with you, and we will continue to support you. God has created each one of you uniquely. You are truly one of a kind, and God has gifted you uniquely too. And sometimes I've found this can be a hard thing to figure out. We all of us ask ourselves throughout our life, what are my gifts? And how can I use them to help make the world a better place? Discernment is a word that we use to describe this process of figuring out what we are good at, what we are passionate about, and how our gifts can be used to help in some way, to join with God, to help heal brokenness and create beauty. And because this can be hard, and also because it changes over time, God gives us a community in which to help us figure this out. It's something we do together as a family, as a congregation, with a group of friends, or maybe with a prayer partner. We Presbyterians actually believe, and it's deeply woven into both our theology and our polity, which just means the way that we are governed. We believe that we are better at discerning, at hearing God's voice together as a group than we are on our own. We are better able to figure out God's call, God's claim on our lives when we are in conversation with others, when we gather with others to talk and to pray, when we study Scripture together, when we work and serve together. And so I encourage you to listen to God's voice in the silent moments of your days and of your nights, to listen to God speaking to you through others, through your friends, through people here at church, through your teachers or other adults in your life, and maybe even through your parents. I know that can seem surprising, but really they do still have a lot to teach you. And through this, you'll discover things that you're good at, things and people that you care deeply and passionately about, things that bring a smile to your face and fill you with joy. And these things, they're gifts, spiritual gifts, we often call them. And we call them that because they are given to us by the Spirit. And it is through the Spirit that we discover them. It's also by the power of the Spirit that we're able to develop these gifts and to use them for God's people and God's purposes. Again, this is a lifelong process. It's certainly not something, at least in my own humble experience, that happens all at once like a lightning bolt. Now, sometimes God does speak in lightning bolt moments, but more often than not, I think, God also speaks in a still, small voice. And so we need to take time and make space to hear and listen for that quiet, calling voice of God. So don't be afraid to sit in silence for a few moments before going to bed, or when you awake in the morning, or maybe even both. Spend time in prayer. Talk to God. Listen to God. Be in conversation with God and also with the people of God. In this day of distraction, we all need to work, actually, at quieting our hearts and our minds, quieting our bodies and our spirits, to allow us to let God in and to become attuned to God's Spirit within us, speaking to us, nudging us, guiding us, comforting us, and also to be attuned to God's work in the world. And so I am excited, as your pastor, I am excited to see how God will continue to shape you and how you will discover the many, many ways that you can bring love and joy and hope into the world, how you can show compassion and care to people, how you can be a voice for the voiceless and a good neighbor to all. And so even as we want to support and encourage you, we can also learn from you. I think we need to learn from you. I think that you all just may lead the way in this post-pandemic world. You are a gift to this congregation and to God. God knows you by name, and God will be with you throughout your life's journey. And one more thing. God is counting on you. God is counting on you to show and share God's love with others. Many have called this being the hands and feet of Christ. And one such person, St. Teresa of Avila, said it quite beautifully. And so I want to close this morning with her words. So I invite you to listen, Flora and Rebecca, Ben and Morette, these words are for you today. Christ has no body. Christ has no body but yours. No hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks compassion on this world. Yours are the feet with which he walks to do good. Yours are the hands with which he blesses all the world. Yours are the hands, yours are the feet, yours are the eyes. You are his body. Christ has no body now but yours. No hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks compassion on this world. Christ has no body now on earth but yours. And so, go out into the world and be the hands and feet of Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now, would you pray with me? Spirit of God, we have gathered in this place to pray and to worship, to hear your word, and to sing your praise. Your Spirit fills this place, Lord, and we are grateful. We are grateful that you have claimed us in the waters of baptism and that you do indeed know us by name. You have called us to be Christ's disciples, and you walk with us on that journey. Give us faith when you come as the wind. Though we do not see you, may we hear what you are saying to us and discern your movement among us. Give us courage, Lord. Let all that is impure, unworthy, or sinful be burned from our lives. Purify us in the flame of fire that represents your Holy Spirit. Give us an open mind, Lord God, that the truth you bring might make its home with us. Truth to set us free, truth to guide and inform us, truth to lead us in the way of your will. Give us open hearts, Lord God, to love without condition and to serve without fear. Holy Spirit, we wait for you to stir us and to strengthen us. Come wind, come fire, come truth, come love, come Holy Spirit. We ask that you would hear us now as we join our hearts and our voices together, praying the prayer Jesus taught all disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
And now we're about ready to go into our confirmation ceremony, but I have a couple words I want to talk about here about our program. Way back in early February, our confirmands started their journey with the new Presbyterian USA confirmation program called Big God, Big Questions. Confirmation programs are designed to invite youth to start answering the big question of Christian faith on their own. These questions are based upon the four questions all members are asked. And they are, trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the waves of sin and renounce evil and its powers in the world? Who is your Lord and Savior? Will you be Christ's faithful disciples, obeying his word and showing his love? Will you devote yourself to the church's teachings, fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and prayers? These big questions were woven into 11 sessions, which we covered, and they are trusting God, sin and how to turn from it, who is your Lord, who is your Savior, what does it mean to be a disciple of Jesus, what does it mean to show Christ's love? Devoting yourself to the church's teachings. What does it mean to devoting yourself to the church's fellowship? and devoting yourself to the breaking of the bread and devoting yourself to the prayers. I admit we had some road bumps along the way, like having to modify our classroom design program into an online lesson because of the pandemic. For the most part, the confirmands held on tight and kept meeting in our makeshift Zoom classroom. I want to thank Ben and Marette and Flora and Rebecca for your patience and understanding as we made modifications along the way. A big thank you to the parents who provided the loving support of whatever it took to get the confirmands online week after week. And a heartfelt appreciation and gratitude to the confirmand mentors, Brent Gregory, Deborah Rosen, Sue Eisenclam, and Ellen Hickey, for checking in with the confirmands as well as attending classes here and there. And finally, a big thank you to Pastor Ann for her guiding support as well as joining some of our discussions. So it's with great excitement to confirm our 2020 confirmands. I invite at this point Rebecca and Flora and Ben and Marette forward.
This is a very exciting time in the life of our congregation as we welcome these confirmands into our congregation. Rebecca and Flora, Marette and Ben, hear these words of Jesus. Jesus said, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit. Anyone who acknowledges me before others, I too will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven." So you all have completed your confirmation class, your studies. You've met with the session. They each met with the session and presented a statement of faith of what God means to them. So I have questions for you this morning for you to answer. So here are these big questions that Chris mentioned in his introduction. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? Do you? Who is your Lord and Savior? Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love? Will you devote yourselves to the church's teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer? Wonderful. Well, you are now officially welcomed into the life of our congregation, and we are very excited. I'm excited, like I said, to see what God's going to do in and through you, and I really do feel like we have a lot to learn from you all, and you guys are going to lead us into this new normal, this new future that God is already out there preparing. So I'm excited to see what God's going to do. And thank you, and welcome officially. I'm going to turn it back over to Chris now.
And as is tradition here, we give out crosses to our confirmands. So at this point, I'd like to invite the parents forward to place a cross upon their child, their youth, I should say. On the crosses here is a very special scripture that is one of my favorite. It's from Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So come on, parents, come on down, and we're going to give you the crosses to put on your youth and young adult. Here you go. This one's for Ben, and here's a cross for Marette, and you can just put it over there.
I will.
Let's give them a hand. And they'll get a certificate as well. Thank you all. And now our call to offering. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but the same God, whose activities, all of them, in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Let us prayerfully give with our hearts as we prepare for the morning offering. Would you please join me in the prayer of dedication? Let us pray. Holy God, thank you for sending your Spirit, the Spirit of the risen Christ, from heaven. Help us to be like the early disciples, praying patiently as we wait for your guidance and power. Fill our hearts and minds with your gifts of faith, hope, and love. May our conversations with people of every language and culture around us witness to your grace and mercy. We dedicate ourselves and our offerings to your good purposes in the world through our church mission by the power of your Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
What a joyful celebration this morning of Pentecost and of Confirmation. It is a delight and a joy to welcome these young people fully into the life of our congregation. So we are blessed indeed, and I give thanks to God. And so now, as we close our time of worship, let us go in peace. Let us go with the knowledge of the deep and abiding love of God, the amazing grace of Jesus Christ, and the mighty power and presence of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God. Amen.